Shouldn't you be in the kitchen?
Don't get your knickers in a twist.
What do you say to a woman with two black eyes?
Should have listened the first time. Smile, love. It might never happen.
How can you trust something that bleeds once a month and doesn't die?
It's just banter.
Why are you always angry? You wouldn't dress like that if you didn't want people to look.
Just a slut that won't shut up.
Get your tits out.
Get your tits out.
Get your tits out.
You look like a total freak. I bet you'd do anything.
Let a man do it, love.
Why don't you just sit there and look pretty?
I'd absolutely ruin her.
You'd be really pretty if you lost a bit of weight.
She was asking for it.
OK, so that's really resonated with our audience. We had 200,000 views this week for that. Do we live in a sexist country? Laura?
Yes.
OK, that's enough. Our next question is going to be...
elaborate. Obviously, you know, I'm being flippant, but the evidence is overwhelming. It doesn't matter whether you look at anecdotal evidence, whether you look at the number of people who came forward there within, you know, a day or two just for that filming, the anecdotal evidence that floods into my website, the Everyday Sexism Project, we've got over 80,000 people's experiences, or whether you look at figures like the fact that 30,000 women a year lose their job because of maternity discrimination, that one in three 16 to 18-year-old girls experiences unwanted sexual touching at school, that a poll just this week showed that 47% of female university students experiences groping, sexual assault under UK law, that two women a week are killed in the UK by a current or former partner, 85,000 women raped every year. I could go on and on and on. I don't know how you could argue otherwise.
It's the statement you made a moment ago about two women a week being killed by a partner or a former partner. I know you have said that in the past, back in December at a TEDx talk you held. That has been proven, has been found to be false according to government statistics. And Mike Buchanan of the political party Justice for Men and Boys has made a public challenge for you to rescind that statement and contacted you directly, and since then you have said nothing.
Obviously, don't do that. How would you respond to that, Laura?
I'd advise anybody to Google Mike Buchanan and have a look at the very many and very detailed rebuttals that have been made of his work. He spent his time writing blog posts where he makes fun of people who talk about feminism but doesn't make any kind of logical points against. I think it's really very damaging, though, on a national platform like this to try and suggest that a national figure, very widely accepted and respected figure, like the figure that over two women per week are killed by a current or former partner, is incorrect. I think it's very dangerous to go around suggesting that statistics like that aren't true. That is absolutely the official figure.
What confuses me about this question is that we've taken the term sexism and we're lumping a lot of things in together into one big steaming pot. Now, any conscientious, civil-minded member of society should absolutely balk at sexual objectification of women, domestic violence, insulting, vile behaviour. Absolutely. It doesn't matter if a man says it, if a woman says it. Collectively, as a society, we should absolutely object to that. But the problem is that when we're talking about... The question that you asked was, is this a sexist society? This is nothing... We're not talking about, is this a society that propagates domestic violence? We have to decide where the lines of demarcation lie. Now, for us to suggest that we're a sexist society suggests that there is absolutely no scope for women to make great inroads into all areas of professional life. And just to throw a few statistics back, and bearing in mind, as the young man said and as Laura answered back, you can make stats work any which way you want if you want to. Politicians would tell you that better than me. But, sorry, cheap gag. But
I don't think you're really sorry either.
But the point is that women regularly outperform boys at school. There are more women going to university now than men. My own son making anecdotalising it. He's just started a course at university. There are 70% of the course is women. It's a medical course. 70% are girls. They all needed really high grades to get on that course.
So why aren't they running all the
companies then? So maybe... I'll tell you exactly why. Yeah. I'll tell you why. So let me tell you exactly why. There are two very good answers to that. Either because they don't want to, or because they can't. Right? Now, there are two very good reasons. Okay, no, I'm not condescending, and that's the problem. Because the problem with the sexism debate is it degenerates into something very personal very quickly, with a bit of name-calling there. It's not helpful. The fact is that, like it or not, biology makes us different. It doesn't make us better and it doesn't make us worse. It makes us different. I'm sorry, Laura, but once you have children, you may not want to have...
Okay.
I didn't mean you personally.
Once you grow up, you'll agree with us.
Sorry. Once a woman has children, she may find that all the greatest plans that she had for pursuing her career, maybe she'll be challenged biologically by the way she feels. Now, you cannot legislate by how you feel once you have kids. And the second thing is, quickly, is that we live in a meritocracy. And I don't know about you in the audience, particularly the women in the audience. I don't want to get a job because I'm fulfilling somebody's female quota or women's shortlist. I want to be the best person for that job.
Okay. So that's Angela's experience. Yes, lady here.
I'd just like to say, Laura, I completely 100% agree with you. As I've grown up, I'm 16 at the moment, I've noticed that more and more I'm witnessing more sexism. There's an area in my street that I actually avoid because I get wolf whistled, which is ridiculous. Also, I'm an aspiring filmmaker, and earlier this year I attended a film networking class aimed at 16 to 18 year olds. And in that class, there are two male directors who are very successful. And I asked both of them, what can I do to achieve the absolute best I can in this industry? And they both said to me, you've got to make relationships with other people. And by that, love, I don't mean sleeping around. I was with two other boys my age. Neither of them received that the same advice. They were like, oh yes, talk to these people, look at these people, sign up for this apprenticeship. He was basically assuming because I was a female, the first thing I do in a professional situation was to go and sleep with someone to promote myself. I haven't even entered the world of work yet, and that's given me an insight into thinking, actually, what is in between my legs is going to determine how well I'm going to do in an industry. And it's absolutely ridiculous.
What's your experience been as a female politician, Leanne? How have you found it? I mean, famously, there are not as many women in politics as perhaps there should be if you look at the sort of nationwide statistics.
No, it's a man's world, there's no doubt about that. Even though in our National Assembly in Wales there are many more women and there are many more women in the Cabinet, and we were at one point a gender-balanced institution, which is something which I'm very proud of. But nonetheless, there is definite sexism within the world of politics. And if you look at the House of Commons, well, you only need to look at the benches to see the gender imbalance there. I think I just wanted to come back on one of the points that was made here about girls outperforming boys in school, girls outperforming boys in university. But then what we don't see is women heading organisations, becoming the chief executive. And whichever sector that you look at, it's men that dominate at the top on the boards and all the rest of it. And I'm afraid until that situation is reversed, then we have to conclude, and I agree with what Laura said, we have to conclude that we live in not just a sexist society, but we also live in a racist society, a homophobic, transphobic society, an ageist society. There is a lot of discrimination out there that we should actually not be prepared to put up with.
So you say, until we reverse that, but how do we go about reversing that? Because Angela just said she doesn't want to get a job because of a quota.
Well, I think Angela said there are two reasons why women don't get to the top. One is that they don't want to, and another is that they can't. And I would say that there are lots of institutional barriers stopping women. There are glass ceilings in organisations preventing women from reaching the top.
And so you don't think it's a meritocracy?
No, I definitely don't think it is. And having children does have something to do with it, because who provides the majority of the childcare in society? And I don't. In my own family, my partner provides the childcare, or otherwise I wouldn't be able to do the job that I do. But in the average family, in the average community, it is women who take that job, not just looking after the children, but looking after elderly relatives as well. Mm-hmm.
Sorry for this gentleman here.
Wait for the...
It's there. Yep.
One idea that seems to be purported a lot is in terms of sexism. Yes, we do live in a sexist country, but one thing the video didn't help with is the fact that people tend to believe that sexism works one way. So the video only featured women saying, oh, nobody turns around and says, okay, what about ideas like the disposable male, male genital mutilation, which everybody is totally fine with. You know, you get circumcised. Man, the idea to man up if you're not strong, if you aren't doing things. Men are expected to do the heavy lifting.
Absolutely. I would accept
it. It works both ways, and that video, you know, for one, didn't help, and quite a lot of responses isn't helping.
That's such an important point. This isn't about a gender war. Look at this panel. Isn't it amazing? We've got an anti-feminist woman and a feminist man. This is, like, how mental is that? BBC3 would you have such a random panel as this?
Non-feminist, sorry.
So this isn't about gender wars. And of course, and do you know what? Men are the victims of patriarchy, men are the victims of sexism, even though, let's not be silly, the majority of the time it's women who are on the receiving end.
It's probably a good time to hear from some men who've got in touch from home. Jack, This kind of proves, you're talking about the film we showed before where people are giving examples of everyday sexism. This proves women are always moaning, ha-ha, exclamation mark. Jokes aside, some of these were offensive, but I feel like a lot of this is banter being misunderstood. I guess women have no sense of humour. And another one, Eddie, who says, one I get all the time, what do you expect? He's just a man. Omar, your response to that one?
I think it's just crazy that that's even, like, it's even uncomfortable listening to it, isn't it? I mean, the fact that within seconds of Laura introducing the debate, within seconds, and, like, respect to you for bringing up statistics, and I'm not having a go or anything, like, well done for even coming to this show. I wouldn't do this when I was 18. I was in my bedroom, yeah? But I was, yeah? So well done. But the fact that within a second, the debate descended into, well, actually, if you look at the statistics, there's this. That would never happen with anything else. Leanne was talking about different types of discrimination. If we said, is there racism in the UK? You'd never have a room of people going, well, actually, I think there was black people just like to moan. We even... We'd never do that! But there's something about our culture that has made sexism just a bit of banter, you know? No, if someone had tweeted in saying, oh, these blacks just like to moan, straight away, someone would be thinking, right, I think that's a criminal offence. With women, it's just a lad. Okay.
Angela?
Enthusiasm, but try not to wallop me.
I
know it's unintentional. Can I just sort of nose this into the fact that you said, is society sexist? If we look at just the counterview in terms of the way it seems to be a one-way journey, there are whole advertising campaigns which are built upon a culture of women ogling men. A certain fizzy drink. Women stop. They stop. I'm sorry, I didn't do the advert. They stop at their lunch break because the window cleaner's going to take his shirt off and open this can of fizzy drink. Women on their hen nights queue up to go and see acts like the Chippendales. They're allowed to catcall, they're allowed to throw things at them. Can you imagine if the same thing happened the other way around?
Yeah, or
if
they're... It does happen.
Yes.
I'm talking about an advertising campaign. An advertising campaign where a woman stopped to have her can of fizzy drink and revealed herself in a wet T-shirt while everybody in the office looked at...
The flake advert?
The flake advert was supposed to be something sort of terribly beautiful and, and romantic. You know, it wasn't about women...
Also, no one from Cadbury's is here to defend themselves, so, Laura.
Angela, I would try and give you back the list of examples in which women are objectified and sexualised and dehumanised, but we'd be here all night and we don't have time. I know that's a joke, but it doesn't happen. The thing that comes up from those comments online, though, is that this is about an attitude problem as well. This is about the way that society treats women. This is about the way that we even have these discussions and talk about these things. It's about that tendency to dismiss these ideas. We're talking about issues as diverse as sexual harassment, to domestic violence, to rape, and people are saying, don't you have a sense of humour? You know, I mean, it's just ridiculous to suggest that women are only four of the top 100 directors of top 100 companies in the UK because they either don't want to or they're not good enough. Isn't that really really the problem, girls? That you just can't be bothered or you don't have the talent?
I object to this kind of, come on, girls, we're all... this stoking up of kind of, you know, we're all militant women together. I think you actually strike a huge own goal. It's entirely counterproductive to kind of rank it up into some kind of militant response. I never for a second suggested that, you know, sexual objectification, domestic violence were not issues that had to be taken seriously. That was the very preface of my comments.
But feminism,
modern day feminism seems to edit as it listens, and that way it becomes entirely counterproductive. There are genuine things, genuine sexist things in society that as society as a whole we have to fight against. But you cannot put issues of domestic violence, which is an enormous problem, alongside whether a woman should feel totally objectified if somebody calls her love or petal or is wolf whistled at. It depends whether she feels threatened, and we have to, as a society, define very carefully the difference between, yes, not having a sense of humour, but actually feeling threatened, and when there are very serious issues of personal safety at risk. And that's what feminism does not do.
These issues are on a spectrum, and actually feminism tackles them as a spectrum. If we see women as second-class citizens, if we teach young girls in the street to grow up and think it's okay for men to shout at them, to shout about their breasts, if we show a naked woman on page 3 of our biggest-selling national newspaper, of course that's I'm not suggesting that somebody goes out and sees page 3 and commits an assault. Of course I'm not. Of course it's not that simple. But we have to look at the context in which we're seeing an epidemic of sexual violence, of violence against women, and we have to look at the attitudes that are at the base of these things. We have to look at the fact that we live in a society that sends incredibly intense messages about women and their role in society from a very young age, and the fact that those kinds of ideas and attitudes about women are also at the root of some of the bigger problems.
I think it's...
Can I use an example?
Related to what you were saying, this is from Abby, and if we're talking about banter, my 16-year-old hears the word rape used by boys at school on a regular basis, but of course it's just dismissed as banter.
I don't. Yeah, absolutely. That's absolutely disgusting.
Is that part of the same culture?
No, I think we have to be very, very... Yes, we have to be clear about what's being used as banter. There is a big difference between somebody rather patronisingly calling me petal, and somebody, and a 16-year-old using rape as if it's some kind of easily dismissive term.
So what if it was a racist? What if it was the racist equivalent of petal, which is another P word? Would you also say that that's
nothing?
Entirely
it's entirely different. And
why is it entirely different? It's discrimination. It's 50% of the country waging war on the other 50%.
Are you saying...
Is it...
serious things from the things that you don't see are more serious, then why shouldn't we also be able to fight things at every level of
you
the
could,
spectrum?
You can, you
why
can
shouldn't
do...
we be able to tackle sexism because... and sexual harassment in the street?
You could, of course you should. There is no, there's a massive difference between tackling sexual harassment in the street and looking at things that are almost trivial and trivialise the big things that you need to fight for and that we all need to fight for in order to make sure there is equality between men and women. So, for example, very quickly, the campaign, I think it was last year or the earlier this year, about having more women on banknotes. What a spectacular waste of time and energy. Make sure women have the exact number of banknotes in their pocket as men. Yes, that's a campaign I would absolutely endorse and support. But wasting the time, I think sometimes modern-day feminism and sexism spoils for an argument to look for.
OK, I want to come into our audience now. Thank you, Angela. Yes, lady here.
I just want to go back to the point about banter. Banter I have with my colleagues, with my friends. I don't get banter from strangers on the street. And I hate walking down the street and being yelled at, being told to smile, love, it might never happen. You don't know what my life is like. And I just think, like Laura said, this is symptomatic of a bigger picture. If we don't stop the street harassment, we won't stop anything else.
OK. Gentleman here.
I think you only need to look back at history, look at the suffragette movement. Like, people lost their lives for the right for the women to vote. And I think it's really wrong that, like, some males trivialise calling someone, like, babe on the street. I think you need to look at the bigger picture. People died for equality and it should be equal. The country should be
equal.
Yeah,
that's a good point.
So the question was originally, obviously, about how do we live in a sexist country? And we've identified in many ways in which, you know, women suffer from sexism, but there is nothing, again, talking about the way the men still suffer sexist opinions in the way that, for example, you know, there's, like, the fact that homeless people, oh, yeah, there is a priority for women. There are... And I'm not saying that, you know, in some cases, like, people who have children, for example, they definitely need that kind of support. But, like, there's... your gender shouldn't make you vulnerable by nature, and it's your circumstance that makes you vulnerable.
OK. Yeah, lady directly behind you.
Firstly, with the militant side of feminism, if that doesn't work, then obviously the suffragettes went about it the wrong way.
I went to school. Secondly,
when we're looking at feminism, what a lot of people seem to be missing is it's actually both sides of the same coin. Men get sexism because of sexism towards women.
Absolutely.
Men get told to man up because
Absolutely.
Feminism is shown as something bad. Women do good in school because now school has become feminized. Girls are expected to be scholarly, they're expected to do well. As a result, a lot of boys don't put as much effort into it as they see it as something that they shouldn't be doing. So, it's the same coin, it's just flip sides
okay.
of it.
So, is that something that you think about as well, Laura?
I mean, sexism is something that has a negative impact on everybody. We get stories that come into the Everyday Sexism Project. We had one the other day that came from a man who asked for paternity leave from work and had been ridiculed in the office for asking for it and denied it. And in the same week, we got a story from a woman who'd been denied a promotion because she was considered a maternity risk. And just as the lady in the audience says, you know, that's two people not suffering different issues, but suffering two sides of the same coin. The same outdated gender stereotype makes things bad for men and women. This isn't about men against women, it's not about vilifying
men. No, it's not a gender war.
It's about people against prejudice.
It's absolutely not a gender war.
Tina, is the power bar up?
Yeah, let's go and get a look at the power bar to see what's happening at home. If it works, yes, it does. Do we live in a sexist country? That's the question that we've been asking during this debate. 81% of people watching say yes. Some of the comments as well, a lot of men getting in touch. And one positive message to start with from Alex. This country has evolved fast. Far more women do dominate and inspire. More can be done, but let's appreciate the progress. And this one is from Namibum. More girls are in uni than boys nowadays because if girls don't get a degree, they're more likely to be in low-paid work. So that's the reason why. And then there's a question for Angela. How would you feel if somebody was doing the same job as you, a man, and got paid more than you?
I'd be absolutely outraged. Of course I would. And it comes back to what I was saying right at the beginning of this discussion, which is that... And, in fact, Laura had somehow come full circle here because what's happened is that originally this sexism and feminism seem to be kind of bywords for each other. But really, which is what I said at the beginning, this is a collective responsibility for society. If there are genuine injustice and inequalities in society, as a society, men and women, we have to address them. That's the key thing. We cannot look at sexism as some kind of a brand of feminism or as something that's tailored entirely towards women. Just as I said, I don't want female quotas, I don't want women's shortlists, I want there to be a meritocracy. And that's why I would be absolutely appalled if somebody was paid more than me. But if we kind of nose the whole debate about unfairness against women, it irritates because some people think, well, this is women sort of, you know, they don't understand that there are men that have issues as well. And we have to work collectively. It's only by working in tandem that we'll address any of the inequalities in society.
So do you feel alienated by feminism as a movement?
Yeah, it doesn't speak to me at all. I went, the young man over there mentioned the suffragettes. My old girls' school, one of the alumni was a suffragette. I went to a girls' school. It was a free place. I was a scholarship girl. There were no silver spoons. And I was taught, came from a very modest background, I was taught, aim high, work hard, and if you can get what you want. And that is the message it's the message I give my own daughter. It's not about, you know, feel vulnerable, feel threatened, don't think that a man can do what you can't do. It's about, you are a person, it's a meritocracy, prove that you can do the job and go ahead and do it.
Lady here, with a couple of hands.
One of the major things is what you're missing is the reason why you've got part of this and the sexism on both sides. And it's a word I thought that was going to be used was lad culture.
Yeah.
Lad culture doesn't even around us students. Lad culture is in the Eatons where they've got their little groups and they have that and they're told they've got to stick to this sort of world that they're supposed to be in. The reason why there are more male politicians, I think, in that top area it's not because the women aren't getting the education. It's because people at that level have the mindset that obviously, oh, you can't let somebody else do that because this has always been a man's position.
Yeah, it's an interesting point. Gentleman here.
Hiya. Just want to say, Angela, the main problem I've got with what you said earlier was something to do with women's biology. Something women are somehow programmed to be a certain way, different to men.
I just said we're different. It doesn't make us unequal. It just makes biology different.
I understand. All I would like to say is that that's not founded by academic research. Academic research shows that nature has a far larger impact. I'm not saying that nature doesn't have an impact on the way we are, but to the extent that you're making out is completely untrue.
Okay.
I'm a primary school teacher, and yesterday I had a conversation with a six-year-old girl, and I said to her, what did you do on the weekend? And she went, I went to a football party, but the girls didn't play. That's not a natural thing to happen. Society has made people think that that's a natural thing to happen, but academic research shows it's not a natural process that we've come to.
Well, okay. First of all, just on a straw poll level, I know lots and lots of women, professional women, highly educated, been successful, who have thought differently once they've had their families. I've met tons and tons of women in all spheres of professional life. So that's one thing. Second thing about kids is kids, I must tell you, do what they want to do. I've got a daughter and three who's got three older brothers, okay? Now, so there are footballs, there are all the sort of paraphernalia of boys around the house. She is empowered by her choice to play with either her dolls or to have a kick around with her brothers in the back garden. Kids, particularly kids today, who are so savvy and so sophisticated, they do what they want to do. And if girls don't want to play football, it's probably because they don't want to play football.
OK, we're going to have to leave it there. Good debate.